Welcome to Commander Central, episode 193, and today we'll be taking a look at the first two Commander 2020 decks, Enhanced Evolution and Symbiotic Swarm. I'm Dana.
And I'm Max.
Max, how's it going, man?
It's going still under self-distancing, quarantine, lockdown here in my apartment.
Same here.
You know, at least it's sunny out, as I can see when I go get the mail.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you're not in a particularly good neighborhood for like going on a hike or anything necessarily either.
No.
We actually have been going pretty much every day, and there's a trail that goes through the woods I can take. And then it comes out on campus at the university, which is, of course, empty. So we walk through the university just because it's, you know, very much like the end of the world because there's just nobody there. So we walk through the campus and then back home. So at least my neighborhood is one that's conducive to getting out and getting some fresh air, you know. But yeah, yours is a little trickier over there. Got to do what you got to do to stay sane, I suppose.
That is so true.
And unlike you, I don't have a convenient panda costume lying around I can change into to relax.
No, I haven't put the panda head back on lately. Maybe I will this weekend.
How many consecutive days with not wearing pants are you on here?
We are on day 9 of no wearing jeans, so I'm either in sweatpants or shorts, but no jeans for 9 days, so I'm on the way to break the record of 12.
Nice.
Hopefully I'll hit that by, you know, Monday.
I did get a backyard's haircut, like I'm a little kid. My wife got scissors out and like just trimmed around my ears and a little bit like back of my neck, so I did get that done. Turned out fine enough, so.
Did she have to bust out the bowl and just put it over?
We didn't get to that point yet, but I mean, you know, give it 6 or 8 weeks and we'll see where we're at.
Yeah, that's no joke. I am afraid I'm going to come out with my long hair again when this is all over.
Yeah, it's been a long time because you, 3-4 years ago, at least that long, you were full on like rock star haircut going
on.
Yeah,
I had hair down to like my shoulders. It was impressive, but I don't want it to get to that again, so this needs to end so I can get a haircut.
Yeah, oh, I hear you. So we have a couple commander decks are fully spoiled. All the commander decks are fully spoiled, and I think our plan is to talk about two of them today and then the other three on the Thursday show. Is that correct?
That is correct. And then I think the following Monday will be, as I call it, Ikoria proper. So the
yes.
Standard set.
And then back with a deck tech. I think we'll try to do a deck tech then that Thursday as well.
Correct. So you get 2 weeks in a row of two shows, everybody.
Nice. Any news or anything worth going into here briefly? I don't think there's anything special really that's happened in the last week.
Ikoria previews have been insane.
Yeah.
To say the least.
Getting those doubled up with Commander stuff has been just bonkers in terms of like information overload, basically.
Yeah, at least, you know, it gives us something to look forward to when everybody's kind of locked at home.
Right.
So it's a little bit of entertainment in these uncertain times.
Very true. Well, if you want to reach out to us and let us know what you're doing during your social distancing / quarantine time, how'd you do that, Max?
Hit us up on Twitter by searching at CMDR Central. We're also on Facebook searching CMDR Central. You can find us on YouTube where all of our shows are posted with the cool infographics behind them now.
Yeah.
Thanks to Raphael, CMDR Central. You know, just Google CMDR Central. And like I said last week, don't go like 12 pages deep, please. I don't need you to know that type of stuff about me.
You can also find us on Patreon.com.
Patreon.com/CMDRCentral. Head over there and check out our reward tiers, the most popular one being the Decks You Play series that we tend to do. We analyze your decks and do a whole show on them.
Yeah, people have seemed to have liked that, much to my surprise. I remember us having that conversation early on, like, we'll get maybe one of those every 6 months is what we thought. Yeah, that has been very successful. People have really liked having a chance to do that. So, and it's been cool for us getting to see a bunch of different kinds of decks as well. So those are fun to do for sure.
While we are on the topic of Patreon, I would like to kind of blast a message out there. We are aware we haven't sent out the playmats for the last handful of Decks You Play series. When we were about to do that, the self-quarantine hit. So they're all currently here in the studio awaiting signatures from the rest of the crew.
Yes, mailing them hasn't entirely been the problem as much as it is getting them signed.
Yes. So we are working on it and they will go out and we'll probably make an announcement when they all go out. Hopefully in the next couple weeks.
Yeah. Like we figured we've already had this conversation. Like Max can put them in a box on his stoop and I can like grab them and let them sit, you know, untouched for a couple days before I sign them and like drop them off at Chris's house or something. So we'll come up with some way to get that done. But that's the problem right now is just getting our physical hands on them in a safe way.
Yes. So thank you for everybody's patience and understanding when it comes to that type of stuff.
Yeah. I never really thought that was something we never really anticipated. The fact that getting together to get them signed would wind up being difficult.
So. I feel like that is the least of like the things we didn't expect.
I guess. Yeah. The grand scheme of things. Yes. we also have a couple contests we wanted to talk about here briefly.
So we will not be doing any contests for the month of, it's April, right?
Yeah,
it is April. There we go. Instead, we are going to do some bigger contests in May when the new Ikoria products finally hit the shelves here in the U.S. So stay tuned and we'll maybe announce those in the coming weeks.
Yeah, for the kind of the same reason, it would be difficult for us to just to get together and like get something signed and together and shipped out. So we're just not doing anything this month. And then next month, we'll kind of make it up to all y'all.
Yeah.
Should we talk about these decks? Because I think there's plenty to talk about and this is going to take some time.
Yeah, I mean, they're okay.
They're fine.
Well, I'm sure we can fill an hour.
I'm kind of curious because I keep going back and forth on them. So I guess I'm interested to see how I feel today because that might be different than yesterday or tomorrow. The first deck is the Enhanced Evolution deck. And that is the Sultai color scheme deck with the face commander being Otrimi the Ever Playful. And Otrimi is the mutate commander, 6/6 for 6 mana, so 3 in Sultai, has mutate for 1 in Sultai. And let's talk about mutate here briefly. Mutate is an ability, it's both in this deck in particular and in the main Ikoria set, and it kind of works like Bestow, I guess, might be the best way to describe it, back from Theros.
It's a more confusing Bestow.
It's a better, but maybe more confusing Bestow. So when the creature with mutate comes into play, you kind of put it either on top of or below another non-human creature that you have in play. And depending on where it sits in that sequence, the creature either gains the abilities of the one in the bottom or has the power and toughness of one of the creatures.
Yeah, so essentially the top creature of the pile will have, that's the creature's power and toughness, and it gets all the abilities of everything underneath it.
Yes, and you can choose that sequence on cast. Yes,
correct.
So, you know, it's their way of, in not silver border, to kind of do that combining a creature thing together. So that's the face card of the set. What do we have for other commanders in here, Max?
Should we read the rest of Otrimi?
Oh, sure. I guess I missed the other part here. Otrimi has trample, and whenever this creature deals combat damage to a player, return target creature card with mutate from your graveyard to your hand. So let's talk about that a little bit more here then before we move on. So this is going to be a commander that primarily cares about mutate. The whole deck doesn't necessarily care about it, but this is kind of going to be the mutate commander. What are your thoughts on Otrimi in general here and mutate in general, Max?
So I like the idea of mutate. I understand it's complicated, but from what I've been hearing on the interwebs, the more you play with it, so like on, I think Magic Arena already has Ikoria out,
yeah,
or at least being able to play with, I think it becomes easier to understand once you actually play with it on Arena or when we get the physical cards. So I'm looking forward to doing that. This deck really reminds me of the Morph deck from last year. It was that one that was,
sure,
kind of unique. There's not a lot of cards that have Morph that could fit into that Sultai color scheme. So I think this is that one niche deck out of the five that's really unique and very specific to the ability of mutate.
Yes.
I think it's fun. I'm comparing just face value a Morph deck versus a mutate deck. I kind of like the mutate deck better, just if I had to pick one, if I was at my LGS and these are the only two decks they have, I'd probably buy the mutate one because Ikoria proper has tons of mutate stuff, so it has at least the support coming with the standard set.
Yeah, I do think the comparison to the Morph deck is a good one, Max, because Morph, I wouldn't say it's parasitic necessarily. It doesn't require other Morph cards to function, but the commander does in that deck. Kadena needs or wants you to cast Morph creatures. So if you're building that deck specifically using that Morph mechanic, you know, you might not get any new cards that interact with what Kadena's doing for the next 3 years now. And to a degree, that's true of Otrimi and Mutate. You don't need to, like, both creatures in a Mutate stack don't need to have Mutate. So if something really good comes out, you know, two sets from now, say a, like, better Vampire Nighthawk that has Flying and Death Touch and Lifelink and Trample and whatever, that's still like you can put that in your Otrimi deck and still put one of your other, you know, 15 mutate creatures as part of that mutate stack and get all those keywords. You might still get new toys for this deck in a way that you probably won't get new toys for a Kadena deck. Does that make sense?
That makes a lot of sense.
So it's, you won't be getting new mutate stuff, but you still have X amount of slots in this deck that you can devote to non-mutate creatures, and you might get new upgrades for there. So it's not as open-ended necessarily as some decks, but I think it's a little better than like a Kadena deck in terms of your ability to get new things for it.
Yeah. Can I just say I really just want to mutate a Blightsteel Colossus? is that weird?
I feel like an indestructible trampling infect creature probably pretty good to mutate. Yeah.
Okay, good. I'm not the only one.
And you're in the right colors to ramp into it for sure. So that's the face commander here. The secondary commander we have here is Zaxara the Exemplar. You want to read that to us here, Max?
Yeah, Zaxara the Exemplary is 1 and Saltai for a legendary creature Nightmare Hydra. It's a 2/3 and has Death Touch, and it also has tap, add 2 mana of any one color. When you cast a spell with X in its mana cost, create a 0/0 Hydra creature token, then put X +1/+1 counters on it.
Well, that's a much different card than the face commander here.
Is this the Hydra commander everybody wants?
Yeah, I think it would be nice if this was red and not blue. I think, generally speaking, there's not a lot that blue adds to Hydras, but I think it's a really, really solid card if you're building Hydras. I like it.
I like it a lot, too. I feel like if this was red, it would have not been Gyrus from a couple years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
This would have been Gyrus. Like, oh, that'd be even better, though. But I agree. It is cool for a Saltai-type deck. But when you think about it, a lot of blue spells have X in their casting cost, so I think yes. This is just supporting those type of cards.
Yeah, it makes it a little more open-ended, I think, letting you cast other things that aren't just Hydra spells, too. So, I mean, there's definitely, you know, it would feel perfectly fine casting a big Villainous Wealth, as if that isn't devastating enough, then it makes a giant Hydra. That seems pretty solid. And while this doesn't really strategically look at all like the Otremi commander, the fact that when you mutate something, you still use half of the body, and there's a lot of like really good Hydras in here that are just generally good creatures, presumably you'd then put the mutate on one of those Hydras, they aren't like really fighting against one another. The two commanders are very different and they want different things, but the cards they like tend to kind of interplay well enough here too. So that's kind of a clever build. They put these two commanders that don't have anything in common, really, but they don't really hurt having them in the same deck either.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
And the last thing we have here is the partner commander. We have a partner with commander in all of these decks.
Yay!
Which I'm a huge fan of partner with, so that's nice to see that back. And here we got Ukima the Stalking Shadow, who is the Dimir commander, and partners up with Khazur, Ruthless Stalker. So Khazur is mono green. Whenever a creature you control deals combat damage to a player, put a +1 counter on that creature. And then Ukima is the mirror one, as I said, and Ukima can't be blocked. 2/2 for 3 mana. When Ukima leaves the battlefield, it deals X damage to target player, and you gain X life, where X is its power. That's pretty good, I think.
I really like the partner with Brink coming back in these decks. This is a really unique pair.
Yeah.
I like that it's about kind of the pseudo Voltron with Ukima. You know, get it pumped up, get a lot of power into it, and then, you know, you can blink it. You're in blue. You have blink spells. You have ways to, you know, bounce it, stuff like that.
It deals damage, not loss of life. So if you want to do some infect shenanigans with it leaving the battlefield, you can do that.
For sure. I think I like these out of all three of them the best.
I was just having this conversation with somebody in chat that I think I kind of like this commander pair out of all the ones in the deck. Although I like the deck, actually. But I think this might be my favorite as well.
I really like the fact that Ukima can't be blocked because it's not as, you know, maybe easy as just throwing it into combat and having someone block it when it's a huge 12-12 or something. You know, you actually have to work to get it to leave the battlefield through either like a sacrifice outlet or bouncing it or something like that.
It solves that problem you sometimes have with these decks where you're like, I need to have 6 cards or so to do this one thing so I can consistently do it and that maybe give it evasion. And then I need to have X amount of cards that buff it to, you know, make that ability worthwhile. And I need to have cards that can sacrifice it or blink it or something. And then you find yourself with a 120 card deck and no idea what to cut.
Yeah.
And by giving it unblockable, you eliminate one whole segment of cards that you have to put in the deck. So that's very, very helpful. I agree. So before we talk about any other interesting cards in the deck, what do you think of the deck as a whole? Like if you get this deck and you shuffle it up and play out a game, just looking at how it is out of the box, what are your thoughts on the job they did making this deck?
Well, I like how like the cards are distributed. There are 38 creatures plus Otremi. All these have a Planeswalker in them. Then there are, you know, 14 instants and sorceries, 5 artifacts, 4 enchantments, and 37 lands. I think that's a really good number for a pre-con, a 3-color pre-con. 37 is solid. You know, you see people like Gavin or other WotC staff on Twitter saying, you know, run 38 lands so you never miss a land drop. And I'm really glad this year we didn't get that deck that had 40 lands in it, you know, for no apparent reason.
Yes, because you can run too many lands. Absolutely. And this deck isn't like super greedy on mana cost. There's not a lot of things that are like triple blue or something. There's also a few smaller creatures that go, you know, have the ability to go get you lands. You have my Dryad, for example. So there's a little bit of ramp here in the form of the many, many creature bodies the deck has. I think the removal suite is a little better than we've got in past years. Like in past years, we don't always get things like Beast Within. Sometimes they just put, you know, Desert Twister we've gotten past in that removal slot. You know, Corrosion Grip is always a nice card to get because sometimes we just get the Naturalize in there. You know, Putrefies. Like, it's not maybe the perfect suite that you'd see in Sultai colors, but I don't think that's a bad start. It's better than we've had in past years.
I love seeing Corrosion Grip because as we go through these decks, you know, the other Commander precons, some of these have stuff you want to stop. You want to split second. You want to stop those abilities. Yeah. So it's really cool seeing them. Maybe they realize that they need something to stop activated abilities. And so why not print an uncommon from Time Spiral way back then?
Yeah. Hey, don't get me wrong. I would prefer if there was even maybe more good cards in here. But like, I think they have stepped it up adequately over the last 2 years. Even the same thing is true of the land base. You know, it's not, again, there's no shock lands or fetch lands in here, but I don't think anyone ever realistically thinks they're going to do that. But there is one of the old filter lands in here. Blooded Woodlands is always a pretty good card in this kind of deck. And we did get a Land of War Wastes, and we did get, you know, Mirrored Landscape again, which is nice. And this particular, actually, in this deck, some of the other decks even have more options than this. But I don't think the land base is really terrible here either.
Yeah, I totally agree. It's kind of light on basics, or weirdly light on some of the basics. Like, there's 11 forests and then 5 swamps and 2 islands.
Yeah. There's definitely things they could have done better, but I would say overall I'm happy with the deck. I think more so than the last couple of years. And honestly, that's probably my thoughts on all of these decks. I think this year they kind of stepped it up enough that I'm not going to complain.
Awesome.
Arcane Signet getting a reprint in all of these decks is really, really nice. And I think there's the reprints in it. You know, we mentioned Corrosion Grip and Beast Within, but like Lifecrafter's Bestiary hadn't gotten crazy expensive, but it was going to get expensive at some point if it didn't get a reprint.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Propaganda is always a $3 or $4 card, and that's a really popular card among people as well. That's the kind of thing that's useful to see show up with a reprint. Deadly Tempest, I think, was a card that got printed, was it last year or year before? It's the board wipe that destroys all creatures, and each player loses life equal to the number of creatures he or she controlled. Deadly Tempest was north of $5, and that kind of needed a reprint as well. So the reprints, you know, there isn't that, like, amazing Wyrmquill Engine reprint or something in here, but the reprint equity is a little bit better than it was, I think, last year as well.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. Are there any new cards in this deck that make you have opinions on? Maybe not excited, maybe you aren't happy about them, but you have any that you want to share opinions on?
I think Manascape Refractor is interesting. It's a 3-mana artifact. It enters the battlefield tapped. It has all activated abilities of all lands in the battlefield, and you may spend mana, though it were mana of any color, pay the activation cost of Manascape Refractor's abilities. I'm really torn on this card. I like it, but I also could absolutely see it being dead in hand way too often. So it's one of those ones I feel like I'm going to have to play it in at least one deck to see how I feel about it. There's a possibility that winds up being a second copy of, you know, Cabal Coffers or Maze of Ith or I don't know what, but I also just worry that I'm going to draw it in hand and be like, I don't want a second copy of Maze of Ith, and I have not, my Cabal Coffers isn't out, neither is someone else's, so I guess I spend 3 mana to have a, you know, land coming, to have an Ancient Tomb come into play tapped, which I guess maybe isn't terrible, but I don't know. I'm curious to see, because I could see it being great and I could see it being disappointing.
That is what I was thinking as well. This card, when it first got previewed, I was like, it took me like 5 times to read this correctly. Like, this can't be real. I thought it was fake. I think we're going to see a mass of them right away, whether it's in the precons or in people's homebrew decks. Like, hey, I would love another Cabal Coffers, you know, like you just mentioned. But it'd be interesting to see how often it is a dead mana rock in your hand, especially when it comes in tapped.
I think Migration's Path is kind of interesting. It's the strictly better Explosive Vegetation. 3 and a green, search your library for up to 2 basic land cards, put them onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. So that's Explosive Vegetation. The difference is it has cycling too. Vegetation is not ideal to play on, you know, turn 4 or something, but like, it's fine. But it feels bad to draw on turn 10 because, number one, you don't maybe need the ramp. The ramp then all comes into play tapped, so you can't use it till next turn anyway. So you're spending 4 mana to get two additional mana that you maybe don't even really need on the next turn. Draw this on turn 10, you just pitch and draw a card. I think it makes up for one of the biggest weaknesses of Explosive Vegetation. I'm not sure I'm still going to start running it, but I do think if you are someone who's already running veggies, this is definitely one I would straight up swap out for it. What are your thoughts on it? Do you have any decks where you'd run it?
I no longer run veggies in Dromoka.
Okay.
I used to. I think I just cut it for like a 2-mana ramp spell or like another mana rock. I do like that it has cycling.
Yeah.
For that late game scenario like you described, for the people out there who run more than, you know, 5 basic lands, Dana, maybe right. They don't have to worry about it late game. But no, it is strictly better. It cycles. It's a 2-mana draw spell, you know, for late in the game.
That's really it for cards that I think are super interesting from here that at least jumped out at me. How about you? Was there anything that you wanted to talk about?
I like the impetus cycles. So they're a cycle of auras. This deck has 3 of them.
Okay.
They all give an enchanted creature plus X, and it gets goaded. So it's
the variant on the vow cycle they've done in the past.
Yes. What I like about this is you can use this as defensive, meaning put it on an opponent's creature, give them the buff knowing it can't attack you until it's down to you and them. Or you could put it on your own stuff because you just have a better board state and you want the damage additions to your creatures.
Yeah, I don't know if I love those necessarily, but they're interesting. They're close enough because Goad is a fun mechanic.
Goad is a really fun mechanic. I do think some of, like the green one, I think is a little overcosted at 5 mana for +3/+3 and must be blocked.
Yeah, I agree with that.
But I mean, I like them better than the Vow cycle. I'll say that much.
Yes, same here. What are your thoughts on Deadly Rollick? So we get a series of these cards. There's a full cycle, one in every color, one in every deck. Deadly Rollick is the black one, 3 and a black. It's an instant. If you control your commander, you may cast a spell without paying its mana cost, and then you exile a target creature. Worst case, that's a 4-mana exile at instant speed. That's not bad. And if you have a commander, it could be free.
And it says a commander, not your commander. So if you are playing like a steel deck, you take someone else's, there you go.
Yeah.
I really like these. I think they're fun. I always like free spells. Hello, I'm the scumbag of the show. And I mean, exile target creature for free is great. 4 mana in black to do it isn't bad at all either.
Yeah, if you have to hard cast that to exile a creature in instant speed, that doesn't still feel terrible.
No, the fact that it's instant speed saves a lot of these all the time.
Totally agree. Yeah, this one I'm torn on. I don't know if I have a deck where I'm going to run it necessarily, but it's really, really close in a couple different ones for sure. I think it depends on the commander. I think if you are playing something like you're playing Mono Black Erebos. So number one, your commander is, you know, not that Erebos isn't fine, but like Erebos is probably never going to be the scariest thing you have in play. And Erebos is tough to remove because it's a enchantment creature. So it's a lot of times going to just be an enchantment and it's indestructible. I feel like you can consistently feel like your commander is going to be in play often enough that this is almost always going to be free. So it's probably much easier to run there versus, say, a Mal'Drotha deck where people are going to be trying to kill your commander the second it comes out. And it costs 6 mana to cast anyway. So I feel like that's going to less consistently be something that you're going to almost always be able to cast for free versus that, you know, say, Erebos deck.
For sure.
But I like it, and I think they are all playable in some way, shape, or form, and I'm sure we're going to mention them when we get the respective decks. So I think those are very, very cool cards. Any other ones that you want to mention here?
I have one more, and it's Dredge the Mire. So this is a sorcery for 4 mana, 3 and a black. Each opponent chooses a creature card in their graveyard. Put those cards onto the battlefield under your control.
So you don't get one of yours, you only get the ones from the opponent.
Right, but
4 mana is pretty cheap.
4 mana is cheap. Graveyard strategies are popular.
Yep.
You know, you have your Mal'Drothas, you have your Shires, all those fun, you know, Alesha. You know, I could see this being used against Chris in our shop.
And what's the worst you're going to get? 3 mana dorks? Well, that's still not terrible for 4 mana.
Right, and if you have a commander that maybe, like, something like Krov, where you're just going to eat them anyways, that's just pure value, in my opinion. 5.
I think that's a good point, though. I do think you want some extra value, and like you said, you mentioned Krov as a perfect example. Like, worst case scenario, you're going to make sausage out of them, right?
Yes.
You're going to get ground up to Krov, and that's it. So even if they give you the most lousy creature possible, you still are probably going to get some form of value out of it. it's not one of those cards. Like, I think Animate Dead is so good and so cheap that, like, even if you have no plan, Animate Dead is probably worth putting in a deck pretty often just because it's so efficient. I don't know if this is that, but I think if you are playing, like you said, the Krav deck, where there's always going to be some utility from those creatures, even if you happen to get things that are lousy, then it becomes way, way, way better.
Yeah.
And there's going to be times when you're like, I'm going to cast this and I'm going to get your Baneslayer and I'm going to get that Consecrated Sphinx and that one person's Bird of Paradise, but who cares? I got a Baneslayer and a Consecrated Sphinx, you know, because those are the only creatures they had in their graveyard. Like, that's going to happen sometimes too, and that's going to look insane. So I like Dredge of Mire as well. I don't have a deck for it or a deck where I'm going to run it, but I think it's a cool card. It's one of those ones that I'm going to see people cast in decks that aren't just this one. They're going to pick it up for their, you know, whatever reanimator deck they have.
Perfect.
Any final thoughts in this deck? Any interest in building anything here?
Maybe not building anything specifically. I think I plan on, for the first time in a long time, picking up all five decks when they do arrive in May.
Yeah.
And I think I want to just kind of tinker around with them right out of the box, just play with them for a while, maybe if we're still under social distancing regulations. You know, it'll give me and my roommate something to do instead of just playing Borderlands constantly.
Sure.
You know, play with them out of the box and see where you can make some minor adjustments to have some fun with it.
I definitely feel like this is the first deck, and I think this is true of a couple of these, where I really find all three commanders interesting. And if I was, you know, doing an event where someone said, hey, you know, pick a commander out of this deck and build it, I would be perfectly fine building all three of these commanders.
As would I.
I think I like the face one probably the least, but I don't dislike it. So I think it's still a neat card. So I think they did an excellent job. If you can make me interested in all three commanders in a deck, you've done something correctly. All right, should we jump over and talk about Symbiotic Swarm, Max?
Let's do it.
So who's the face commander here?
The face commander is Cathril, Aspect Warper. It's a legendary creature, Nightmare Insect, for 2 in Abzan. It's a 3/3, and it has a huge old novella of text on it.
Yes,
and it
does.
And it says, Cathril, Aspect Warper, enters the battlefield, put a flying counter on any creature you control. If a creature card in your graveyard has flying, repeat the process for First Strike, Double Strike, Death Touch, Hexproof, Indestructible, Lifelink, Menace, Reach, Trample, and Vigilance. Then put a +1/+1 counter on Cathril for each counter put on a creature this way. So this already starts off with something new. Keyword, counters.
Yes.
And I think we talked about this last week on the show.
We did. And it's a theme in the Ikorium proper set as well. That's a lot.
That's just another Abzan graveyard commander.
But it does an interesting thing with it, I think. I think the fact that it gets kind of big based on the amount of counters that you put in, you're spreading around some keywords, so it has some synergy with some existing kind of keyword soup commanders that we have, whether it's, I think, does the second Odric cares about it. You have things like Majestic Mitriarch that care about it. So there's some extra synergy with cards that already do exist. I think this is interesting. Would you build this commander, or what are your thoughts on it?
I think it's interesting to build. I tried doing the keyword soup Odric back in the day. I think adding, you know, my favorite color, green, to it makes it a lot easier, because some of those keywords are just inherent to green. Trample,
yes.
You know, stuff like that. So you're less reliant on maybe artifacts, like I was in a mono white deck.
Right.
But like you said, there are a bunch of other cards that already do this. There's Odric, there's the Majestic Matriarch, there's Concerted Effort that all kind of do this ability. So you have some redundancy, which you could build into your deck.
You have some redundancy, and you also have a commander that's probably going to come into play at least as a 6/6, if not, you know, bigger than that sometimes. Probably going to have some kind of evasion, probably have some kind of protection. So you have kind of your commander damage win condition right there. I think, like, people will probably just two-shot people with this commander pretty frequently as well.
Yeah, I think this would be a really cool thing to build as, like, a Voltron-type deck, where you have a bunch of little bodies that have keywords. You sack them off to generate mana. This comes in. You build it up, you give it haste somehow, and boom, you one-shot someone or two-shot someone in the next couple turns.
Well, and that's a good point. Haste is the one thing that isn't on there.
I wonder why.
Yeah, so you are going to be reliant on your Lightning Greaves or something along those lines to give it haste. Still, it's a fun commander, and I like the interaction.
Yeah.
So next in this deck, we have Taim, Luminous Enigma. Taim is 1 in Abzan, for Nightmare Beast, 3/3. Each other creature you control enters the battlefield with an additional vigilance counter on it. So we're back to keyword counters again. And you can spend 3 mana to remove 3 counters from among creatures you control, put the top 3 cards of your library into your graveyard, then return a permanent card with converted mana cost 3 or less from your graveyard to the battlefield.
I didn't know Tiny Leaders was coming back.
That's weird. So yeah, 3 or less. Now to do that, it says remove 3 counters from among creatures you control. Doesn't care what those counters are. Doesn't care if they're -1/-1 counters, if they are the vigilance counter on it that you make when creatures come into play. That's all irrelevant. It's also not a tap ability, so as long as you have the mana to do so, you can remove counters and remove the thing from your graveyard and put it into play. So this feels like a combo deck waiting to happen, although there's no obvious combos that leap out at me when you look at it.
There has to be some sort of like winter, like stasis lock, or, you know, winter orb, some sort of like stack. This is going to be a stack deck.
Definitely, for sure. Or at the very least value, where you're like, I'm going to, you know, remove the counter from my Glacial Chasm every single turn so that can stick around forever. And there's creatures that come into play with a -1, you know, of your own, that their downside is has a -1 counter on it comes into play. Or you put a -1 counter on it when you do an ability, so this lets you eat those off it as well. The one thing I think when we talk about it being a combo deck, though, I still feel like, well, you're in Abzan, so you could just play Gave Guru of Spores, which combos with everything. So like, if you want to combo bad enough, there's better ways to do it than Taim here, I think.
I definitely think Taim is one of those legendary creatures that goes into a bunch of decks. It goes into a Gave deck.
Sure.
Probably could go into like an Anafenza the Foremost deck, but I don't know. I'm interested to see listeners' lists based on Taim, just because I don't know what else to do with it besides stacks.
Yeah, no, I actually kind of agree. This is, of the 5 commanders we looked at so far, this is the one that I maybe have the least clear understanding of how you'd build it.
Yeah.
So what's the last one? We have a Partners with Pair here, Max. Going to read it out to us?
So we have another Partners with Pair. We have Yannick, Scavenging Sentinel. It's 2 green and a white for a 3/3 legendary creature, Hyena Beast. And it partners with Nikara Lair Scavenger. Yannick has Vigilance. And when Yannick, Scavenging Sentinel enters the battlefield, exile another creature you control until Yannick leaves the battlefield. When you do, distribute X +1/+1 counters among any number of target creatures, where X is the exiled creature's power. Nikara Lair Scavenger is 2 and a black for a 2/2 legendary creature, Human Cleric. It partners with Yannick. It has Menace. And then whenever another creature you control leaves the battlefield, if it had 1 or more counters on it, you draw a card and lose 1 life.
So it's asking you to build some really specific stuff, but I also like this pair. What are your thoughts on them? Would you build this deck?
I don't know if I would build this deck specifically, mainly because I already do like Blink Shenanigans with Brago. If I didn't have Brago, I would probably try it out. I do think, like the other commander we just spoke about, these kind of go in the 99.
Yeah.
Versus kind of, I'm sure the people who build this deck, and I know like Brando over at CCO is super hyped on this. They're going to be cool. I mean, it's +1/+1 counters. That's what, you know, Abzan likes to do. There's some exiling, and you have baked in card draw with Nikara. It's going to be a cool deck. It's not my type of thing.
I also feel like this is another one of those decks where there's going to be a lot of, You want a lot of different things. I want an X amount of cards that come into play with counters on them. I want, you know, X amount of ways to blink things. And again, I think the deck is going to be very, very busy. There's going to be a lot of things you're trying to do with it, I think.
Yeah, I definitely think you have to decide, do you want to go more Nikara's route and just make sure they have a counter? Or do you want to go Yannick's route to make sure you play big creatures that you can exile with Yannick to make it super big?
Yeah, but I like it. I like this pair, and it's one that, again, I think if you gave me this deck, I'm maybe least excited about Taim, but I'm interested in building the other 2 commanders, and I would probably be okay with figuring out a way to use Taim as well.
Yeah, I'm sure I'll repeat myself on Thursday, but the fact that all these come with partners with commanders, I love that mechanic. You said it earlier, you like it.
Yep.
Like, out of anything, I could see myself building the partner decks, even though they may not speak to me now. Give it a few months.
Yeah.
I have an epiphany and start going at it.
How about any new cards that we have that are here? Anything that you really like or really dislike?
I love Bloodcurdle. So this is a instant for 3 and a black. You destroy target creature, but then you put a menace counter on a creature you control. Longtime listeners of the show will know menace is one of my favorite keywords, just because I like, you know, I like the combat step. I like to be able to beat face, so being able to get my creatures through, this is just a great way to remove something that's in my way, and then make sure a creature can get through for an ability on damage or just damage in general.
And especially if you're playing the keyword soup thing that cares about those counters, it's just one more way to put a useful counter on something and not have to just run, like, there's added utility. I'm gonna make the menace counter that Cathro's gonna care about, and I'm gonna remove a creature in the process.
Yeah.
There's actually a Death Sprout in this deck, which is a card from I think
War of the Spark.
Yeah, 4 mana, destroy a creature, search your library for a basic land card to put onto the battlefield, tap, then shuffle your library. I don't love Deathspark, like, just in general, but I like it in my Kresh deck, where I care about killing creatures, because there's added utility there of buffing Kresh. So if I can do two things at once, ramp out a land and buff up Kresh, that extra utility makes it worth spending the 4 mana on Deathsprout. This kind of feels like that if you're in the deck that Vigilance is added, or that Menace is adding some extra utility for you, it makes sense then spending maybe 4 mana on a removal spell to do that. So we mentioned the cycle before with the possibly free to cast cards if you control your commander. This one has Obscuring Haze, which is 2 and a green. If you control your commander, you may cast a spell without paying its mana cost. Prevent all damage that will be dealt this turn by creatures your opponents control. So it's a one-sided fog for 3 mana, which isn't terrible at 3 mana. I mean, if someone's alpha striking you, okay, you prevent the damage, but you also can still block stuff with your creatures and possibly get some kills in. So it's you're paying a little bit more for fog that's not just stopping all damage, it's just stopping your opponent's damage, but it could be free too. Where does this one, do you think, Stat? Do you like this one as much as the black one? Less? More? What do you think?
I think I like it about the same. I'm weird on fogs. I like stuff like Teferi's Protection or Heroic Intervention. And this is sort of like Teferi's Protection in the sense that it's just preventing the damage.
Right.
I do like that it's all damage, so this doesn't have to be used in the combat step. This could be that the hard-to-cast Niv-Mizzet. You know, they say, oh, I'm about to combo off, and you just cast this. You know, there you go. You prevented all those draw damage triggers from happening.
I mean, I won a game, one of the EDH Reccast games we streamed last week. This would have stopped my final kill because I got a kill by, I killed Joey with tokens and then sacrificed the last, you know, X amount of creatures to, I think, Spawning Pit to get Vela damage on Charlotte Sable from the Nakai, who was playing with us. And this would stop that. Prevent all damage will be dealt by creatures to your opponent's control. This particular fog in her deck, you know, and she was playing, I think, a Angus Turbo Fog deck. Had she had this fog, that would have stopped that win.
Yeah.
You know, it's a fine card on its own. Casting it for free is good. I think this is probably my least favorite of the ones that we've seen of the five, but I think it's still a pretty good card. I don't know if I have a deck where I'm gonna run it, but I like it, and it's gonna be annoying, particularly in green where you're not expecting someone to cast something. Like in blue, you sometimes are like, does he have Force of Will mana? Let's find out. In green, you're oh, they're tapped out. Well, I'm good to go. Nothing's gonna happen, and then you get fogged. So I like it. It's interesting, even if I maybe don't have a home for it. I think Bonder's Ornament is maybe interesting. It's an artifact for 3. Tap it for 1 mana of any color, so it's a manalith. But for 4, you can tap it. Each player who controls a permanent named Bonder's Ornament draws a card. The odds of anyone else running this are pretty slim. So it's basically just going to be 4 mana to draw a card, which is lousy. Except for it's on a mana rock, and people oftentimes, they're already running manalith anyway. So like if you're okay with running 3 mana cost mana rocks, having the option to draw a card maybe isn't the worst thing in the world. Or maybe get lucky if someone else is playing one and they draw a card, then you get to draw one too. So I don't even know if it's going to make the cut in Jeru, but I thought about it, and I do think it is an interesting design. Any more from you want to talk about here, Max, that you like?
I really like, so this kind of goes into the keyword soup part of this deck. Avenging Huntbounder. It's 3 white-white for a human warrior, which is a 3/3. It has double strike.
Yep.
But when it attacks, put a double strike counter on another target attacking creature. So like I said last week, these counters are really nice because they're permanent. It's not till end of turn. They stick there. So this is a really cool way over time to build up a team with double strike.
Yeah.
Like, if you're playing original Aurelia, every time this attacks, give Aurelia double strike. Oh, next combat, give something else double strike. You know, this is going to go into a lot of cool extra combat step decks or, maybe not token swarm decks because it's going to be hard to give each little 2/2 token double strike, but, you know, maybe those white weenie decks is that thing that kind of nudges them ahead, or some Boros decks even, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it also, because the creature itself has double strike, it works just fine in the Cathro face card deck because it has the ability on the card itself. It's not just when it comes into play, put the double strike counter on it. So because it has the ability, it also works nice if you care about the keywords, particularly for Catherall. Yeah, that's a cool one. If I was playing something like Simut, you know, combat damage stuff where all your stuff is going to get haste from Simut, then you have the option to put double strike on her or whatever. I guess, does she have double strike by default? She does.
Yes.
But on something else in your deck, I mean, I think that plays nicely with that kind of commander too. So yeah, that's a good one. That's an easy card to overlook, but actually I think it's really, really solid. I agree. I don't think there was anything else here that jumped out at me. I mean, like, there's some fun cards, like Slippery Bog Bonder is just a fun card because it, you know, gives some, there's like some meme quality to that. And it's not a bad card. Flash and Hexproof. When it enters battlefield, put a Hexproof counter on target creature, and you can move any number of creatures from among creatures you control onto that creature. That last ability probably isn't going to happen that much, but like, you flash this in and prevent someone from removing something else you control, and then this sticks around being hexproof as well afterwards. It's not a bad card in addition to just kind of being funny because it has a Slippery Boggle on it.
Okay, Dana, as the person who uses their life as a resource of the most out of any other commander player I know, I would like your opinion on Netherborn Altar. This is the artifact for one in a black. It has tap, put a soul counter on it, and then put your commander into your hand from the command zone, then lose 3 life for each counter on Netherborn Altar.
So the first time that you use this, and it won't be worth using until your commander's already died once, because, you know, casting it from the command zone or casting it from hand, at that point, if it hasn't died once, it's not saved. There's no commander attack, so it's not saving you anything. So it's really only getting you ahead on mana once you have had your commander die. In addition, this costs you 2 mana to cast in the first place. So you're spending 2 mana to get it out to save yourself 2 mana once your commander's died once. That isn't necessarily a great deal. So if you use it a second time, then at that point you're getting 2 mana ahead, but you've at that point, you know, you're losing 6 life for it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And again, had you cast a mana rock, you know, cast an Everflowing Chalice for 1, which you could have done on turn 2, and then every turn thereafter it produces 1 mana for you that you use. I don't know. I feel like the amount of games where this is better than having just ran a mana rock in that slot seem like they're going to be pretty few and far between.
Okay. I definitely agree with what you said. It's going to take a while to get online. In my opinion, you need a commander that costs a lot.
Yeah.
Just to make it worth it. I mean, I originally thought maybe you'd try this in Glissa because it's an artifact.
You can bring it back.
So you could sack it, get rid of that counter, bring it back. So you at least have a way to not let it accrue a lot of counters on it.
Sure. And maybe if you had, I don't have a ton of artifact sack out with my Glissa deck.
True.
You know, but maybe in my Vela deck, but I don't cast her that much. Usually she doesn't get cast until I'm going to do something to win the game.
Mm-hmm. We all saw that happen last week.
Yeah, right. I was at 5 life. Speaking of losing life, I was at 5 life in that game when I wound up winning it. And I didn't cast Vela until the last minute, so that's kind of the same thing. I do think there's decks maybe where this is fine, but I think it's not as good as maybe people think it is. I just think you'd be better off most of the time just spending that 2 mana on a mana rock and using that, you know. There's going to be times when you top deck this on turn 10, and you're like, oh, my commander's got command tax of 8, and I'm going to pay 2 for it and tap it immediately and lose 3 life and save myself 6 mana by moving it to my hand and then cast it, and it'll feel great. But I think that, like, that's going to happen just so infrequently. I think most of the time you're going to draw it on turn 2 and be like, I wish this was an Everflowing Chalice.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I think that one is one that I don't love a lot. We also have Cartographer's Hawk in here, which is the new white bird. And when it deals combat damage to a player who controls more land than you, return it to its owner's hand. And if you do, you may search your library for a Plains card and put it onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. I think, number one, that's odd in a deck that has green in it. You just have access to 50 better ways to ramp in that. But outside that, like, so let's say you're playing mono white. What do you think of this in general? Because I don't love it necessarily.
So I instantly compare this to like something like Core Cartographer, which if you can't abuse it, you only get a Plains card off of Core Cartographer when it enters the battlefield. I do like that it's only 2 mana and it has evasion.
Yeah.
So
sure.
That's a huge help. So worst case, you cast this turn 2, you can swing on turn 3. You either are withholding the land drop from you, your hand, so you can go fetch a land, or you know, are just lucky and nobody, you know, someone has more lands than you and you just do it.
Right.
This isn't something I want to see late game.
not at all.
This isn't something I want to put in my Dromoka deck because it's right. It's a 2/1.
And it's a green deck where you already have ramp in there.
Right. And I think I run Birds of Paradise still, but that probably is going to get cut eventually.
Yeah.
It's nice they are trying to put more effects like this on cards for white.
I agree.
You know, they can't reprint land tax every commander set because, you know, it's land tax. They can't reprint Tithe because it's on the reserve list,
It is, yes.
Okay,
it is.
There we go. So it's cool. Do I think it belongs in maybe a different deck? Yes, I think this probably could have gone in the Jeskai deck.
Sure, or the Abzend, not the Abzend deck,
The Mardu deck.
Mardu deck. Any deck that isn't green, basically.
Then again, the Mardu deck is humans. We'll get to that on Thursday. But it also does have a keyword, flying. So it does play for, you know, cool. You get one hit with this, and then it dies the next turn when you block. It gets blocked. And then it's in your graveyard for when you cast Cathrill. You know, it's cool. I get it. I get why it's in the deck. It just should be in a different deck, in my opinion.
And if I'm playing some kind of bird tribal deck where I have the added synergy of it being a bird that's going to, you know, interact with my other birds doing things, great. I would definitely probably run it there.
And you know, here's something else. If we're looking at a mono white card, it already has a contingency on someone whoever you're hitting has to have to a player. Yeah, so it has to hit a player who has more lands than you.
Yep.
So why does it have to deal combat damage? Why isn't this an attack trigger?
I agree.
Why can't it just say, whenever you attack someone with more lands than you, go fetch a land?
It feels really, really safe.
Yeah. I feel like this was almost like a standard card. And then they're like, oh, nope, let's put it in Commander and change some verbiage.
Well, like turn two, you know, if I drop this to continue the same discussion, talking about a mana rock with the Netherborn Altar, kind of a similar thing here. If I drop Everflowing Chalice on turn two for, you know, one or Thought Vessel or whatever, okay, I guess I can tap it for a colorless mana, and on turn two, what are the odds of you using one colorless mana are pretty slim, but it's still there. And then on turn three, you can tap it for a colorless mana, and on turn four and on five and on six and on seven, you know, every turn thereafter you're making a mana. This is going to come into play, get you a land on turn three, which comes into play tapped. So, like, you're not going to get that first mana until turn four off this versus turn two. You're already now multiple mana behind, and this goes back to your hand, at which point you have to then recast it. So, the next turn, like, if you're playing in a deck that has native haste or something, maybe it's a little bit better or faster, but I think there's decks where it's going to be fine, but I think I'm going to see it in a whole bunch of mono-white decks or Boros decks where the person will be better off just playing a mana rock, I guess is the simplest way to phrase it. I think it's fine, but it's not as good as I think people are going to be wanting it to be.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Okay. Any final thoughts here before we wrap this up?
Out of the two decks we looked at today, I think I prefer the Mutate deck over this one.
I think I do as well.
All five of these decks have had me more excited than the Commander precons in the last 2 or 3 years. I think the last time I was this excited was the four-color decks. And those had attracts in them, so, you know, let's take that with a grain of salt. But I'm really hyped so far for all five of these decks, and I can't wait to get my hands on them.
I think last year there were decks that I was just like, eh, whatever, I don't care if I see what's in it. Not that there were bad cards in it, but like the Savin deck, for example. There was nothing in that deck that really that seemed interesting to me. I'm not saying it's bad or anything. I'm just saying, like, on my personal emotional reaction, I read all the cards in that Savin deck, and I'm like, it just is not at all interesting to me. I believe I had the same reaction to the Madness deck. You know, it was fine, but I was like, yeah, it's just not. It doesn't hit anything in me that makes me like, oh, that's cool. Both of these decks have done that thing for me where even if I'm not going to maybe buy the deck, and I think I will, they're at least like, oh, that's a pretty cool deck. I can see why that would be fun to play. Emotionally, these have connected with me in some way, and I think that's not something that happens every single year. So at first, I was a little bit like, there's a lot going on here. But as the week has kind of rolled past, I found myself enjoying what we've seen so far, and I'm looking forward to talking with the next three to see if that continues.
Yeah.
Okay. That will wrap up the first show of this week's Commander 2020 review. We'll be back on Thursday talking about the other three decks. Thank you very much for our editor, Rafael Garcia. You can find him on Twitter at Ursa Bearwalker. You can find me at Dana Roach. You can find Max at CMDRCentral_Max. And you can find Chris at Wise Squishy One. Our podcast theme is Retro Future Dirty by Kevin McCloud, licensed via Creative Commons. And we'll be back on Thursday. Until then, I'm Dana.
And I'm Max.